Now we're almost home free. So the first thing I want to point out is that we can reintroduce these absolute value signs without killing anything.
Mm-hmm.
Well, because we can. This is a positive quantity, and so taking the absolute value doesn't change it. So the last little thing to point out is that if we take the max of this same quantity, substituting in different values of A, this can only get larger or no smaller because this A that we're maxing over includes A1. So we can definitely achieve at least this value, but it's possible that some other action will let us achieve an even larger value. But by maxing, we can't have it achieve a smaller value. I mean, it could achieve a smaller value, but it'll be at least the max will be at least as big as what we get for A1.
Right.
And with that in place, that actually completes the chain of inequalities from here to here. So we get this non-expansion property for the max operator. The max operator is being used here as sort of a way of summarizing these functions f and g.
Okay, so let me just say that last thing back to you, make certain I got it. So I'm with you all the way to f of a1 minus g of a1. You went to the absolute value signs. That's pretty easy because we already knew that value was positive, that difference was positive by construction. And then that last step, you've noticed that the difference between a1, f of a1 and g of a1 is some number. You're maximizing all possible a's you could stick into f and g. It has to include A1 by definition, which means the max might be bigger, but it couldn't be smaller than A1. And so therefore, you're bounded from above.
Excellent. Good. Yeah, well said.
That's really cool. Now I've forgotten why we did this.
I find that's often true for me as well, that this requires enough of my attention that I lose context. But the context was that we had this step in our proof that the Bellman operator is a contraction. We needed it to be true that summarizing the Q values at a given state using a max was going to leave us with something that is no farther apart than the maximum difference between the two functions that we started with.
Okay. Yeah, I remember that. Maybe you can show me the equation again.
And in particular, it was this step right here where essentially we had to, one way to think about it is move this max out of the absolute value. So if we compare that to what we just proved, that's what we did. We kind of moved the max out of the absolute value.
Right. That's awesome. Good. Okay, so I get it. So the Bellman operator is a contraction operator. Value iteration works.
Yes, indeed. Now, I went through a phase of my life where I got really kind of fixated on non-expansions and identified a whole bunch of other operators other than max that are also non-expansions. And that actually gives us a way of analyzing a whole bunch of other kinds of decision processes, right? So not just these standard Markov decision processes where we're trying to maximize expected reward, but we can do a lot of other things, and this same kind of proof is going to end up holding. So we're going to get back to that in a moment, but first I want to talk about how we use this property, now that we've established it, to prove the convergence of Q learning, right? To prove that this interesting way of updating the Q values over and over again in the face of experience actually does, in the limit, lead you to getting the solution to the Bellman equation.
Okay,